So I'm going to talk about visual texture analysis. And this is work that I've done with a lot of collaborators. Primarily, it's the work of my former PhD student, Jana Zugovic, but it's collaboration with people from many different universities from United States and Europe, and now most recently at Lawrence Livermore. Starting with texture can be a lot of things. Okay, it can be a natural texture, it can be some material like leather or canvas. Okay, it can be a distant texture. We can think of the leaves of a tree as being texture. It can be an actual painted texture, like a cloth. Okay, I've done work in the past in halftoning, that's also a texture, even though there you're trying to hide the texture. And here is one of the key leaders in texture analysis, Bella Yules. He worked on some fundamental analysis of textures. He generated synthetic patterns to study fundamental properties, and he's also famous for the random dot stereograms. So what is texture? Here is a loose definition that I borrow from Portiga and Simoncelli. It's a spatially homogeneous image that typically contains repeated structures, often with some random variation in positions, orientations, or colors. Now, the main problem I've worked on is texture similarity. That's a difficult problem in itself, but I also want to, in this talk, start thinking about material properties. So what you have here is illustrates, and I'll be more concrete, why the texture similarity problem is difficult. These are obviously similar textures to a human, but if you were to subtract these two, you would see a lot of differences. These I consider identical textures that are taken different pieces from the same photograph. But here I have moving towards material recognition. Here we have two textures that are also obviously the same, but they're taken with different lighting conditions and different point of view. And similarly, here is some water with different lighting conditions. So thinking about material identification, the challenge is what I have here is three examples from the Curet database, the Courant and Utrecht has been around for a while. These are the same material with different lighting and different viewing orientation. Okay, so these are the same material. And then as I was trying to study a similarity, I tried to find textures that look the same, but they're different materials. And this was the best I could do. And these are quite similar, but not the same. Actually, this poses a very interesting question. I mean, in color, for those of you that are familiar with color, we have metamerism, where we have two spectral distributions that look the same, that the human eyes see as the same. And the question is, can we find two different materials that when you take a picture, they appear the same? Well, apparently it's very difficult if you include color. If you remove color, it's very easy to fool the eye. It is very difficult. Again, I looked, maybe there are, but I couldn't find any. So this is encouraging because it tells us that visual texture contains a lot of information about material. Now, I'm going to go through a quick review of where we can use this. Primarily, I've been thinking of texture similarity, but now material identification is where my interest is going to. I mean, if we are doing indexing and retrieval, it can be visual similarity, or it could be actually material retrieval, okay? For image compression, we really care about appearance, and actually texture similarity metrics are the basis of one of my recent research interests in going from what we call perceptually lossless coding, the equivalent of MP3 perceptually lossless audio coding, to in images, what JPEG is perceptually lossless, to what we call structurally lossless, where the two images look the same, but if you look carefully, they're quite different. Here I've changed the hairstyle of the baboon, but they're both acceptable baboons, okay? So I've been doing work on structurally lossless compression. Also, actually, I'm going to be giving later this month a talk at the IEEE section, and I gave an earlier talk in this location on tactile acoustic representation of visual signals. So if you want to translate a visual signal to a tactile pattern, okay, you need to understand texture. And one of the most important problems is semantic information extraction. Their material is very important to understand the real material. And texture plays a big role. And actually, what motivated my interest in texture research was a talk by Ted Adelson in 2001 that he said that computer vision has focused on objects rather than material perception and texture. So texture can tell us a lot about materials. Now, there are a couple of other applications that I've been interested in more recently. Image restoration, there's been a lot of work on exploiting the self-similarity of images for restoration. The non-local techniques are, I believe, the state of the art, some very amazing algorithms. So what they're trying to do is really identify parts of the image that are similar and put them together to do denoising. But this doesn't work well. It may work here. There is some texture here, but it's very regular texture. But if you have stochastic textures, the techniques break down. And I've been working with Alessandro Foy and his students to use texture similarity and try to extend the techniques to texture. Another problem I've been working on is classification of images for virtual colonoscopy. These are healthy vessels. These are cancerous vessels. And people have been trying to analyze vessel by vessel, but if we think of them as texture and we analyze the statistics, we can very easily classify them, and we've been working on these. Okay, now, why is texture similarity difficult? Well, we talked about PSNR, about mean squared error, and PSNR is a derivative of that. Okay, the higher the PSNR, the more similar it should be. Here are two images that are textures that are completely different. The PSNR is 11. Here are two that are much closer, it's lower, and two that I would consider identical, and it's even lower. So PSNR fails. Subjective similarity, of course, moves that way. Now, the metrics, some of the metrics I've worked on at least point in the right direction. Okay? So here the metric, the higher the value of the metric, the more similar. I'll briefly talk about these metrics. Here is another example where we took a texture and distorted it by warping. And here is obviously different, but it gives the highest PSNR. And again, the same textures give the lowest. And if you take this texture and distort it, you get higher PSNR value than for the undistorted one. So, and by the way, again, some of the metrics we developed at least point in the right direction. Maybe the numbers are not as perfect as we want them, but at least gives the right ordering. One more comment about texture similarity. Some people can think that these are similar because they have similar colors. Some people may say these are similar because they have similar structure. That's a subjective effect, and it may depend on the application. So our approach has been, let's consider the two problems separately. Actually, it's very easy to ignore color. You just take the grayscale component of the image. To isolate color, it's more difficult. We've done it in some way, but it's not as trivial. A very quick review of similarity metrics without any equations. The main idea is to move away from mean squared error, point-by-point comparisons. What we do is we use the steerable filter decomposition. That's a subband decomposition. A lot of image processing relies on such decompositions. Then we compute statistics. So this is one typical, the frequency segmentation of that steerable decomposition achieves. We look at each subband, and we find the mean variance, simple statistics, first order autocorrelations, horizontal and vertical, maybe even diagonal, but actually we found these are adequate. And also cross-band correlations. And I show here, we only find the cross-correlations between adjacent bands linearly, and then within one scale at different orientations. Once we collect these statistics, then we need a formula to compare the statistics. We need something. So there is a formula. I'm just not listing it here. Okay? And then you need to pool the subbands over all subbands in special locations to get an overall measure of similarity. A lot of this work was motivated by work on texture analysis synthesis. Actually, there is one of the nicest publications by Portiga and Simoncelli. They use about 700 parameters to characterize textures. But this is analysis synthesis. So there was a question in Professor Giannakis' talk about reconstructing, the human brain doesn't reconstruct either, okay? So in analysis synthesis, we want to reconstruct, but here are looking at similarity. So really, we don't care about 700 parameters. Our theory is like maybe 50 to 70. We'll do even less, but that's the order of how many we're using. Here is my only, well, one of two equations, I guess. If you have all this data, okay, all these statistics that I'm talking about, there are many ways to do this comparison and pooling. Perhaps the simplest and I believe the best is to just construct these vectors for the two images you want to compare and then do some kind of difference. Actually, the most general form is that we've been using is a Mahalanobis distance between the two vectors. And of course, you need to estimate the values of the matrix. And we've been working on that and different approaches. And actually, most recently, we're using machine learning techniques to estimate the matrix M. But this is like the overall comparison that gives you the similarity between textures that are characterized by vector fx and fy. Now, so this was like my very, very quick overview of similarity matrix for grayscale. For color, here are two textures that we want to compare. Okay, so the approach is to first abstract the most important colors. So we do a bit of segmentation and reconstruction. So you abstract what we call the dominant colors of these textures. Then you have here, you list all of the colors, okay? And then you need to compare this color composition with that color composition. So we've removed basically the structure, and we only retain the color composition. And we want to compare those. And we find the best way to do this is what is called what we call optimal color composition distance, proposed by a colleague at Bell Labs, Mojsilovic. And actually, it's the same idea as you may have heard of the Earth mover distance, which is well known in information theory and recently introduced in computer vision by Leo Gibas's group at Stanford. So that was my quick review of color composition and grayscale similarity matrix. Now, the big question is, if you have a similarity matrix, how do you know it works well? Now, if you think of all the possible textures in the world, you want the similarity that given any pair of textures, you want the metric that given any pair of textures will give you an appropriate similarity value. Now, that's a fairly complicated problem. There are lots of textures, okay? And if you randomly pick pairs and you try to train your texture, okay, you might end up with textures that are irrelevant for really determining how well it does. So we thought about the problem, okay? And then we looked at different, you know, textures you may want to compare. And what I show here are pairs that are dissimilar. Okay, so it is important to be able to tell that these are dissimilar, but as far as deciding whether this is more dissimilar than that, it doesn't really matter. Okay, we do want to tell that these are more similar than these, so we want to distinguish similar from dissimilar, and more importantly, we want to know that when we have identical textures, if it's the same thing. Okay, now this is, for retrieval, this is perhaps the most important thing to be able to do, but if we go into coding, Then fine detail matters, okay? So here we have an original texture, and then it's geometric distortion. So we should be able to order this according to distortion, okay? If we're going to be close to the original, okay? And here is JPEG distortion. Again, we do care about ordering these. But there is no ordering when we're talking about these, okay? And that's a mistake a lot of people do when they try to evaluate metrics, and that was what was holding us back. So we decided that to test the matrix, we need to define domains for testing, okay? And these domains are based on what humans can do, okay? And then the requirements of applications. And we found that there are three domains, okay? We decided there are three domains. One is quantifying small amounts of distortion, and then distinguishing similar from dissimilar textures, and then retrieving identical textures. And there is a question of picking a threshold for the metric that we say above this threshold, things are similar, or above this threshold, things are identical. So here is like a conceptual plot of what we want the metric to do. What we have here is subjective scores increasing similarity, and here is increasing similarity according to an objective metric. And we only care about here at the top of the scale where we have small distortions that we have a monotonic relationship. And then we want high values for similar. This is the similar range. And then low values for dissimilar. And we don't care about these variations. OK? Now, is that a surprise? No. If we look at color, which is much better understood than texture, OK, we have what are called the macadam ellipses. This is a visualization of all the possible colors at one intensity. Okay, these are indistinguishable colors. This is kind of the perceptually lossless case. Then we need another ellipse where we have the identical textures and then similar textures. Okay, but even in color, I mean in color for similar textures or almost the same textures, there is what is called the perceptually uniform color spaces, like LAB and LUV. But if you move over long distances, there is no quantifying of color differences. So if you are comparing red and green and blue, geometric distances don't mean anything. So the same thing is happening in color, and it's much easier than texture. OK, so now the first problem is the retrieval of identical textures. That's very easy to analyze. What we do is we take textures that we consider perceptually uniform, break it into pieces, and we expect the metric to retrieve these as identical. They don't look the same. They are not exactly the same, but they have the same statistics. They are the same texture. Okay. So then there is a number of statistical tests. One is statistics, the precision at one. You count how many times you succeed to recover the identical texture. There are some variations of this. I won't go into the details. Mean precipital rank and mean average precision. Basically, you can take different metrics. Different metrics are different colors. You can compute these statistics, precision at one, for example. And you can see that PSNR is the worst. Structural similarity metric, for those that are familiar, is also very bad. If you do it in the complex domain, it gets better, and then you get better metrics. Again, I'm not going to dwell on which is better or not, but this gives you a way to evaluate metrics. Now, this is still relative. I want to know what's the best one I retrieve, the closest to this. But if you ask the question, what is the threshold, then you have to look at the distributions of the values for similar and non-similar textures. And here, PSNR, you see there is overlap in the histograms. But for a better metric, they are separated. Then you need to pick a threshold. And the receiver operating characteristic tells you how well the metric does. So this takes threshold into account. And again, you can see the closest to the right angle, the better the metric. So we have an evaluation tool for metrics. Now, similar versus dissimilar, how do you test those? Well, you need to construct groups of similar textures. And if the metric gives you high values within the group, and low values across groups, then you have a successful metric. How do you construct a similar group? Well, we did the work for that. We devised a new procedure. Basically, the idea is, given a lot of textures, you want to form groups. You form them gradually. You show people textures. You ask them to form a group. You show them gradually. They cannot form at first, but then you give them more textures. They refine the group, and eventually they come up with a uniform group. You do this several times, you combine these, and then you get the similarity groups. So this is actually a very useful tool for understanding texture similarity. Okay, talk to me if you, yes.
So you're doing multiple hypothesis classification here, is that what you're doing?
Or yeah, you don't know what they are. I mean, you just say, find the similar group. Yeah, yeah, multiple groups, similarity groups. Okay, so I think of the stars and find the galaxies. Okay, so, well, actually, that's an interesting question. If there are galaxies or if it's a continuum, okay? Now, again, now you have the statistics, you use the same statistics and evaluate the different metrics, and you get different performances. Again, similar and dissimilar is the same statistics that come up, and you can have receiver operating characteristics. Finally, especially for compression, you need to quantify small amounts of distortion. For that, what we decided to do is, again, based on some of the problems we're looking at, we created distortions of different type and different severity. We asked people to evaluate the distortions, and then we looked at how they correspond with human perception. I won't go into the detail of this, but it involves some psychophysical techniques like multidimensional scaling or Thestorian scaling. And again, we can correlate performance. And again, now it's interesting, PSNR is doing a lot better, and some of the metrics that were doing better before are not. So different problems require different metrics. Again, if you are interested, I can go into more detail about all this. Okay, but we have a systematic way for evaluating metrics in each of these domains. Now, I think I have about 5 more minutes, so I want to get into material properties. Now, this, what you see here are the same texture at different lighting conditions and different viewing angle. So the appearance of a texture depends on the material itself, transmittance, reflectance, okay? The geometry of the surface, the lighting, and the viewing angle. So that's a very difficult problem. And if you try to separate this, it's what people in image processing call inverse optics approach. This is computationally intensive, unstable, very, very difficult. The question is that what the brain does? Because you're motivated by human perception. The alternative approach relies on natural texture statistics. It's called the ecological approach. And the theory is that statistics are easier to compute, okay? And they can tell you what you need to know without teasing apart all of this, okay? So it works fast because I guess our humans need to make decisions fast. Is this a crocodile that I'm looking at, or is it something, some other innocuous thing, okay? But it can make errors, and visual illusions illustrate that can be errors, but most of the time it's right. So the idea is, again, rely on texture statistics. Now, well, we talked about statistics for similarity, but now if we move beyond similarity, where we still have visible differences, okay, substantial differences, how can we separate different materials? Can we do that? Well, that is the problem. So one approach that people have been taking is let's look at specific texture attributes like roughness, glossiness, okay, directionality, and so on. Okay, and these we can estimate beyond the range of identical textures or very similar textures and can provide strong clues about material properties. So we want to understand some of these properties, and in particular, glossiness is one that we studied and others have studied. Okay. So the approach that we took is, if we change the image statistics, for example, we can change the skewness and the kurtosis of the distribution, and we study the effects of perceptual attributes, that can tell us a lot about how we perceive textures. And Winches and Pond have, based on some underlying imaging characteristics, they proposed this, what they call the lambda curve, for the transformation input intensity and output intensity. We've experimented with S-type curves, okay? So what we did is basically took an original texture and then transformed it, okay? Actually, it's very interesting. The lambda transformation can take white spaghetti and turn it into black spaghetti, okay? But we study what happens, okay? How the image changes and the perception changes and how the statistics change, and we try to draw conclusions. Okay, also this is the S transformation. Okay, so then we did that and did a lot of subjective tests, which I don't have time to get into the details. But we found a weak correlation with the parameter lambda and the perceived contrast, whereas there was much stronger correlation with the S curve. Okay, well, actually the slope of the L, my student told me to be very careful with this. Okay, the slope of the L lambda curve and the slope of the S curve. Okay. That correlates much better with gloss and contrast. We also found that contrast and gloss are closely related. Okay, so this updates the skewness hypothesis of Motoyoshi and others. Okay, in Ted Adelson's group, that they found that perceived that skewness influences gloss. Actually, contrast. Oh, I do have. Okay, well, I'm almost done though. Okay, so that is. So basically, again, to go back to what we're doing, we are looking at image statistics and how changing statistics changes the appearance of a texture and how we perceive the texture. Okay? Now, still that doesn't tell us how we identify materials, okay? But these attributes are characteristic of materials. A glossy material is different than a non-glossy material, okay? Like glass or whatever, I mean, than a mud surface, okay? But what we're also hoping, and this is really future work, is because we look at different textures at different viewing angles and different lighting conditions, we cannot just apply the similarity matrix. But we have this similarity metric tool, and how can we use it? Well, actually, if we were to use a transformation on the image that will simulate changes in illumination and viewing conditions, okay, then we can apply similarity metrics and then identify the material. So this is only one possibility and one theory, but this is a very intriguing thing to do. So we're working on seeing how, for example, we try to compensate for gloss differences by changes in illumination direction. So that's what we're concentrating on, okay, to get to material perception. So this is it. Thank you.
Yes.
No. I'm not clear about perceptual features, I guess, versus the computer features.
Well,
you're talking about comparing human perceptions, right? Human beings looking at something and judging it versus a computation.
Well, we are trying to get. I mean, I talked about different parameters, different dimensions like roughness and glossiness and so on.
Yeah.
Okay. There is subjective perceived roughness, and there are metrics for roughness. We have some very simple metrics for roughness. I didn't talk about them, okay? They don't quite work very well, but we have some first steps. Glossiness, I'm not aware of any. The beginning is looking at skewness that Adelson proposed, but it only holds if you have every condition fixed. I mean, it's been shown that it's not true in general. So if you have a very controlled environment, change one parameter, maybe. Okay, so it's a very difficult problem. For directionality and regularity, you can do much more. Okay, and I had some actually undergraduates derive some metrics. Okay, scale is another very interesting problem. It's very relevant. Okay, so there are objective metrics, and then there is perceptual metrics, how we perceive them. And perception is really our guiding principle. I mean, humans are very good at interpreting the world. I'm happy if my objective metrics can do as well as human eyes can do. So we're not trying to outdo human perception. We're trying to approach human perception. Did that answer your question?
Yeah, I think I get it now, because I know of roughness measures or features.
Well, if you look...
I haven't heard of glossiness. Roughness
is especially interesting because roughness, there is acoustic roughness, which is very intriguing. Actually, I'm working with René Van Egmont on acoustic roughness models. There is tactile roughness, and there is visual roughness. And even the relationship between visual and tactile roughness is very intriguing. For other things, glossiness, I don't know. Maybe there is a corresponding acoustic thing, okay? There is no, well, I guess there is. I mean, anyway, understanding each of these is very intriguing. People in mechanical engineering have roughness metrics, but they just look at the profile, basically. They have a probe that measures deviation from a flat surface.
Like a phonograph record.
But this is tactile, right? It's not visual. Okay? So visual is very different. And even if you do tactile, I mean, you have to take the characteristics of the finger into account, and you have to take the sensitivity of the sensors into account. So even for that, we don't have very good metrics. Actually, we are working on this kind of metrics for tactile roughness. Okay? Again,
the curve that I didn't understand. Is
that... that's just think
is
of it as...
measuring the perceptual?
No, this is just a transformation. Oh, sorry. This is not... There is a basis for this. If you take the lighting from above, and you have a Lambertian surface, and then you change the direction of illumination, this can simulate changes in illumination. That's where this came from, but it's very limited. Well, this is input intensity and output intensity.
I'm sorry?
Input intensity and output intensity. So you just change that, it's a contrast, well, yes, modification of your intensities.
One quick question.
Yeah.
Yeah, have you gotten to the point yet where you can take an image, and this is a tall order, so I'm just trying to find out where things are.
Yeah.
Have you gotten to the point yet where you take an image, say a color image, or a black or a grayscale, monochrome, and on a per pixel, you can A, learn the textures that are native to the image, and B, can assign each pixel in the image a particular texture label.
That's a segmentation. I've worked in actually with segmentation before I worked on this, but it's a very difficult problem.
Yeah, it's really hard at the top
order, because one of the problems you have is, for a particular pixel, you don't know how big the neighborhood around it is
exactly.
to characterize
exactly.
the texture.
Actually, the techniques that we've worked on, there is the contradiction there, right? I mean, the bigger the window, okay, the less the resolution you have, okay? So, and also, if you have a very big window to estimate the texture, if it's especially varying texture, then you don't have accurate estimates. So the solution is very intensive computationally. Actually, my first PhD thesis at Northwestern was on this. We took variable size windows, so we started with rough estimates on a large window, and then reduced the size of the window to get more precise, okay? As we get more better estimates. So there are interesting approaches, because if you look at human perception, we have no problem finding the boundaries of texture, right? So that was the challenge, and I think the variable window size is the key. But it's computationally very intensive, and how many parameters do you use? We try to use a few parameters, like dominant colors and dominant orientations, and did fairly well, but it was like 3 hours to process an image.
Trick that somebody had discovered.
I don't believe in tricks, actually, but that's okay.
Well, thank you very much.
Okay.
Any